evening of June 18, 1815, the army of the Duke of Wellington huddled in their bivouacs around the fields of the tiny Belgian village of Waterloo. The incessant rain made the men miserable, wet, and cold. But those same men would soon have cause to celebrate the downpour which had marked the previous night. Not only did that famous summer rainstorm save many of their lives, it also helped to change the whole course of European history, which was to be decided here on the field of Waterloo. The tiny island of Elba had been unable to hold the exiled Emperor Napoleon Bonaparte, the key figure in more than 20 years of turmoil and bloodshed on the continent. After his escape from exile, the Emperor had returned to France. Buoyed up by his enthusiastic reception in Paris, his vaulting ambition and lust for power remained undimmed. Although his popular support was building week by week, Napoleon was able to field an army of only 280,000 men. By contrast, ranged against him were the combined forces of five allied nations, which could mobilize some 800,000 men, with more to follow.
Napoleon, when he returned to France in 1815, in March 1815, found himself facing a very grim strategic prospect. The Allied powers of Britain, Austria-Hungary, Russia, Prussia, and indeed even Spain and Portugal had all declared war on him personally, not the French people, but Napoleon Bonaparte himself.
The Spanish were moving to the frontier, the Austrians were moving to the frontier, a large Russian army was on the march to join the Austrians, and in the north, Wellington had the Anglo-Belgian Dutch army, and there were the Prussians under Blücher.
The French army itself was not the army of 1805, and the heroes of Austerlitz and Wagram, for example, were buried beneath the snows of Russia. So this was a sort of pale shadow of the army that had given him many, many victories early in his career. But it was still a very good army, full of a lot of veterans. And more important, it was a homogeneous army.
Wellington, with an allied army of 110,000 British, Dutch and Belgian troops, was to attack Paris from the direction of Brussels. His left flank was to be protected by Marshal Blücher, with 110,000 Prussians advancing on Namur from the direction of Liège. General Schwarzenberg's 1st Austrian Army of 210,000 men was to attack France from the direction of the Black Forest. General Fremont, with a small force of 75,000 Austrians and Italians, was to move through the Riviera to threaten Lyon. Finally, there were 150,000 Russians under Barclay de Tolly, who would stage a drive into France from over the Rhine. Once these forces had destroyed the local opposition, they were to converge on Paris itself.
It would take time for the Allies to mobilize these vast armies. And in the meantime, in the spring and early summer of 1815, there were only two armies in Belgium ready to actually face Napoleon's threat. These were the Anglo-Dutch army under Lord Wellington and the Prussian army under Prince Blücher.
Napoleon's strategy was based on having to defeat Wellington and Blücher individually before the other armies could arrive.
So the situation was, which one to strike at? Now, there was tension between the British and the Prussians. Neither really trusted the others. Their two armies were near, but separate. So Napoleon saw this as an opportunity to divide those two armies, overwhelm them in turn, march on Brussels, and hopefully bring the Dutch and the Belgians back under his control.
It should be remembered that all of the coalition powers were at each other's throats during the Congress of Vienna. So a victory against Wellington and then against Blücher, for example, if it were accomplished, could quite easily have resulted in the Austrians and the Russians withdrawing back to the borders of their own countries, and a prolonged war, which the British government probably didn't want to look forward to.
In strategy, there is no victory. And Napoleon was, if anything, a gambler.
Knowing that he had fewer troops than Wellington and Blücher put together, Napoleon's aim was to drive his army like a wedge in between these two enemy forces, and then destroy each in turn. Wellington's army drew its supplies from England via Ostend, while Blücher's Prussians drew supplies from Germany. By striking at the hinge where the two armies joined, Napoleon hoped that his opponents would retreat away from each other towards their supplies, making it easier for him to encircle the separate armies and meet them one after the other on more numerically equal terms.
The two sides actually were not evenly matched if you combine Wellington's army and Blücher's army with the French, which is why he had to defeat them individually. The main thing was to keep them from combining.
He knew that his French army was composed of veteran soldiers that had served under him in many campaigns. Thus he could trust them in battle and knew that they would be effective, even though their numbers were limited at around 80,000 men.
Initially, Napoleon's strategy appeared to be working well. On June the 16th, Napoleon's troops defeated the Prussians at Ligny and gave the British army a serious mauling at Quatre Bras. By doing so, he kept his opponents apart as planned, forcing both armies to retreat away from his outnumbered Grande Armée.
Napoleon is actually able to drive the British and the Prussians apart. He creates the conditions for a victory, but it is not the victory that he actually wants.
Despite the fact that Napoleon was able to really savage the Prussians, the fact that they were able to retreat parallel with Wellington was absolutely crucial to the Allied cause and fairly fatal to Napoleon's.
Crucially, Napoleon's intelligence network had broken down, meaning he did not re-establish contact with either of his opponents until late on June the 17th. By then, Wellington had taken the fateful decision to stand and fight at Waterloo on June the 18th, safe in the knowledge that the Prussian forces, only 8 miles away at Wavre, would be able to come to his aid that same day. Napoleon, on the other hand, was unaware that the Prussians were so close. As far as he was concerned, they were continuing to retreat, pursued by Marshal Grouchy, who had confidently assured the Emperor that he would keep the Prussian army on the move away from Wellington. Napoleon believed he could now fight on his own terms, and he chose to attack the English army first. And so, on this farmland near Brussels on June the 18th, 1815, the Emperor risked everything on a final dramatic gamble. He knew he must destroy the British before they could rendezvous with the reforming army of the Prussians, or lose everything. The battlefield of Waterloo is remarkably small. It measures a mere 1.5 miles north to south and only 3 miles from east to west. Wellington had chosen an excellent defensive position, blocking the road to Brussels just south of the village of Waterloo. His own command was located in a vital position at the crossroads on the ridge. In addition, strongholds were established in 3 substantial farms along the British front line. One such building lay at Papelotte on the British left wing. One was in the centre at Les Essons, and the third was in a hollow over on the right, the Chateau of Hougomont. These buildings were strengthened to form miniature fortresses capable of breaking up French attacks before they reached the main British fighting line. Wellington had selected a position for his troops which at first glance is unremarkable, but closer inspection reveals a gentle ridge.
It's not apparent immediately that this is good defendable ground. In fact, you would look at it and you say, well, it's just rolling, gently rolling country. What's so wonderful about it? And it takes the eye of a superb tactician to actually see how you can convert these valleys into killing grounds and how it's going to be very, very difficult to actually bring troops in a direct line from La Belle Alliance up to La Haye Sainte.
Generals of the Napoleonic era made a great show of positioning their men to face the enemy, regardless of the dangers of artillery fire. It was considered unmanly and even cowardly to place men out of harm's way. In sharp contrast to this practice, Wellington invariably chose to place his men on the far side of the slope of a ridge, out of sight and away from the enemy guns. Besides the reduction in casualties from artillery fire, there was one other major benefit. From Wellington's position at the crossroads, the French dispositions could be clearly seen from the ridge. From Napoleon's headquarters at La Belle Alliance, however, the dispositions of the British troops were not visible. This was to be a significant factor in the coming events. Despite having the tactical disadvantage, Napoleon had no choice but to attack. It may have been bravado, but he's reported by one witness as having said that this matter will trouble me no more than eating my breakfast.
Napoleon was very confident of himself. He was scornful about his enemies. He first of all had never, of course, met with Wellington before.
He also believed that Wellington would not actually put up proper resistance at Waterloo. He knew Wellington's strength, he knew the strength of the position. He felt that he was clearing the road to Brussels. He was expecting one attack to actually push Wellington off the ridge and that Wellington would then have to fall back. So he was not really expecting a full-scale battle.
He considered the Allied army of the Duke of Wellington to be, as we know, a hodgepodge of all sorts of different contingents from European armies.
Wellington's Allied army was composed of British, Dutch and Belgian troops with some German elements. It totaled some 68,000 men that day, comprising 50,000 infantry, only 20,000 of which were British, 12,400 cavalry and 156 cannon served by 5,500 gunners. On the French side of the field were 49,000 infantry, nearly 16,000 cavalry and 246 cannon served by 7,000 gunners, a force of roughly 72,000 men, which meant that Napoleon had succeeded in bringing superior numbers to bear against the British, although only just. As he surveyed the French troops, which he could see perfectly, Wellington knew that both armies were fairly evenly matched in numbers, but that the French had the edge in enthusiasm and experience over his Allied army. Wellington, however, did have one massive advantage. He'd received news that Blücher's Prussian army was marching to his aid. However, he had no way of knowing if they would arrive in time. In fact, as he waited, Wellington knew there was no guarantee the Prussians would appear at all. Throughout the long campaigns of the Napoleonic Wars, French artillery had proved to be the most destructive force on the battlefield. Napoleon himself had been an artillery officer and understood the full power of well-directed cannon fire. Explosive shells still lay in the future, but the cannonballs of 1815 could still do enormous damage as they ricocheted off the ground, cutting huge swathes through densely packed troops, ripping off limbs, sometimes killing several men at a time. However, as we have seen, on the night before the Battle of Waterloo, torrential rain fell. Both armies were exposed to the elements, and the incessant rain left the hungry men cold, tired and miserable. Little did they know that the source of their misery would save many of their lives, for by dawn the fields of Waterloo were flooded by the unforgiving rains. Now, instead of bouncing off the ground on their trail of death, many cannonballs would simply bury themselves harmlessly in the muddy earth. As well as artillery, the infantry weapons of the period were also susceptible to wet weather. The muskets carried by the infantrymen of both armies were loaded and primed using black powder, which had to be kept dry in order for the weapons to be able to fire. So Napoleon had to decide, should he wait for the ground to dry out, making his artillery more effective, or should he attack? Crucially, he chose to delay. Perhaps a younger, fitter Napoleon would have chosen to attack at first light. But now, approaching 50, after a lifetime of campaigning, Napoleon was in poor health. Maybe this is the real reason why, at this critical moment, he chose to wait.
He certainly wasn't in the best of health, and if we can believe the reports, he was feeling unwell. The years had obviously taken their toll, but it's a bit of a myth to say that he was all washed out and he wasn't really up to it.
You have to say, though, that he still actually retained his abilities as a commander, and in fact the Waterloo campaign strategically is one of his greatest achievements, because he did actually manage to confound both Wellington and Blücher and to separate their armies at Quatre Bras and Ligny.
The wet ground had much more to do with what was going to happen at Waterloo, and this is a serious problem.
Certainly, the French artillery did have a great deal of difficulty in bringing its guns up during the morning due to the mud. But there was also the added complication of the fact, which is often ignored, that many of the French troops had broken ranks during the evening of the 17th of June and into the 18th of June to find food and shelter. And in fact, many of the French troops were not back in the ranks until round about 11 o'clock in the morning.
In contrast to Napoleon, Wellington was still an enormously able general and highly popular with his men. Above all, he had not been beaten by the French throughout the long years of wars in Spain. At 46, he was the same age as Napoleon, but suffered from none of the effects of the physical decline which troubled the emperor. Although Wellington had a reputation for aloofness, he had a genuine concern for his men, who knew that he would not carelessly squander a single life. On occasions, he'd shed very real tears over casualty reports.
Napoleon was in a sense unfortunate in that in the most crucial single engagement of his entire career, he was to come up against a general of the track record and experience of Wellington. Wellington was almost undefeated throughout the whole of the long war in Spain. He was an excellent commander of men, he was a great leader, and he was a superb tactician. He had learned a great deal in the peninsula about how to husband his resources, and in particular to protect them from the particular tactics that the French were using, which is very large-scale use of artillery and columns of attack. What was new at Waterloo, and which Wellington gathered very quickly, was that suddenly he was facing large-scale French cavalry.
Napoleon knew that Wellington had become anxious about his line of retreat to Antwerp and on to England. He planned to exploit this anxiety by opening the battle with a subtle game of bluff. By attacking Hougoumont, Napoleon wanted to make Wellington believe his line of communication to England was about to be cut. He reasoned that the threat of a French breakthrough on the Allied left would cause Wellington to divert men away from his centre to protect this vital escape route. This deadly ploy would clear the way for the real French attacks, which would be made in the centre and on the left. Before the diversionary attack was made, there was a long pause. For what seemed like an eternity, Napoleon hesitated as both armies stood immobile on the sodden field. Napoleon had decided to recall Grouchy, whom he believed to be in headlong pursuit of the Prussians. But as the hours ticked by, there was still no sign of Grouchy or his men. Finally, at 11:30 a.m., unable to postpone the attack any longer, Napoleon gave the order to attack the Chateau of Hougoumont. The Battle of Waterloo had begun. As we have seen, the operation was primarily designed to draw away British troops so that the British line would be weakened when the main attack was launched against Wellington's centre. But Hougoumont was a formidable obstacle in its own right. The houses and barns which still surround the chateau are linked by a high brick wall with a gate. In 1815, these buildings were defended by the crack light infantry companies of the British Guards regiments. These were some of the best men in Wellington's army, and they would play a major role in the coming struggle.
The fight for the Chateau of Hougoumont was only ever really intended to be a diversionary attack, but it's one of these situations where the prize becomes attached with a significance which it didn't really have, and it drew in more and more French forces, and really what should have been a small diversionary action became a kind of mini battle within itself.
It begins to suck in the whole of Riel's corps, more and more troops, and it's going on without the slightest reference to what's going on in the rest of the battle. And it's using an entire French corps, and what are the British using? 3 battalions.
Like the day itself, the battle for Hougoumont was to prove a near-run thing. Gradually, the British troops defending these orchards and gardens were forced back until a party of French infantry managed to burst through the back gate into the courtyard of the chateau. With the French troops now inside the buildings for a few desperate moments, the fate of the British at Hougoumont and perhaps the Battle of Waterloo itself hung in the balance. A savage melee erupted, a fierce hand-to-hand fight to the death. British Captain James MacDonald of the Coldstream Guards organized a hasty counterattack and by sheer brute force got the gate closed again. That gate still stands today, marked by a monument to the bravery of the British Guards who died in this attack.
It anchored Wellington's immediate right flank. It tied down something like 14,000 French troops. We'll see later on in the day how Ney's pleading for reinforcements, and Napoleon made the famous comment, well, you know, where do you expect me to get them from? Do you expect me to make them? Well, of course, there were a few thousand being sucked into this diversionary action at Hougoumont.
Even with Hougoumont secured, Wellington was still deeply concerned. As the fighting intensified all along the British lines, a French victory looked ever more possible. Wellington's main hope of victory, of course, still rested upon the arrival of Blücher's Prussians, and he must have been greatly relieved to receive the news that they were moving closer.
Napoleon had dispatched Grouchy with 30,000 men to keep the Prussians on the move. He wanted and expected them to be forced back on their own lines of communication to Namur. The problem was that Grouchy became involved in a battle at Wavre against only part of the Prussian army. This left Blücher to bring at least 2 corps onto the field of Waterloo.
Napoleon was therefore forced to draw off a large portion of his reserves to guard his flank before the battle in the centre had really started. A battle which he would now have to fight with one eye over his shoulder.
Throughout the day then, Napoleon, without any real intelligence as to Grouchy's position, was constantly looking for Grouchy's corps of 30,000 men to come to the battle and turn the tide.
Unfortunately, they were actually marching away, and it takes a bit of doing to achieve this, from both the battlefield at Waterloo and the Prussians. It was quite a feat of generalship when you think about it.
You've really got to put yourself in Grouchy's shoes and say, yes, I can hear the guns, but my orders are to pursue the Prussians. He failed ultimately in his objective, the 30,000 men that he had with him, you know, they could have been very, very useful at Waterloo, and it was a big, big absence.
Despite the bleak news and the absence of Grouchy, Napoleon knew that Blücher's army could not begin to arrive until around 7 p.m. There was still plenty of fight in the French army, and at about 1:30 that afternoon, their drums rolled, sounding the signal for the great attack in the center to begin. Four divisions of French infantry, some 12,000 men, commanded by General d'Erlon, now made a furious assault on this small farm in the center of Wellington's line, Les Saints.
The struggle around La Haye Sainte was really pivotal to the battle. Hougoumont is interesting. Hougoumont is actually removing the French reserve, but it's a battle within a battle. La Haye Sainte is the key to the main battle.
It was vital that the French took it. It was like a rock. Every time the French attacked, they had to break around it.
The farm was admirably defended by one lone battalion of the King's German Legion, a total of 600 men, one for every 20 of d'Erlon's troops. Despite the disparity in numbers, the King's German Legion made a stubborn and determined resistance, turning the little farm into a formidable fortress. The bitter fight for La Haye Sainte raged on. Wellington's forces were becoming hard-pressed along their entire line. Still awaiting the arrival of the Prussians, and with the pressure building, the British troops grew ever more exhausted. Even Wellington, the Iron Duke, was forced to contemplate the unthinkable prospect of defeat. To the right of Les Saints, d'Erlon's 12,000 Frenchmen were on the brink of a decisive breakthrough against a British infantry force only 3,000 strong. But a famous charge by the British Union Brigade turned the tide. Led by the Scots Greys, mounted on their magnificent grey horses, they galloped forward and forced the attacking French forces back. As chance would have it, the Scots Greys swept through the Gordon Highlanders and both regiments charged together, yelling "Scotland forever!" This gallant and uplifting image has inspired artists for generations. Together, they charged onto the French guns, sabering the gunners and putting the French to flight.
It's one of the great decisive uses of cavalry, and it is probably the greatest decisive use of British cavalry in military history.
We have the famous beautiful horses thundering down heavily against the French. They broke right through a division and a half of these troops.
This is the very intimidating 1796 pattern heavy cavalry sabre. Each of these heavy cavalrymen would have been armed with one of these. Not been regarded as being a very effective weapon, but in the hands of a big British dragoon seated on an even bigger horse, was capable of just breaking a lot of bones and lopping off a lot of limbs, as well as taking a lot of lives.
The French guns' main battery, Napoleon's ground battery, is up in the reach just in front of them, and they charge on up into the ground battery. But by this time, of course, Napoleon has activated his cavalry reserve, Polish lances, who put in a devastating counterattack. And for all intents and purposes, Ponsonby's cavalry brigade is destroyed.
Of the 2,500 cavalrymen who made the charge, more than 1,000 were killed during the action. This is where they died. Their heroism was certainly not in vain. d'Erlon's shaken French corps would need time to regroup. This bought the time Wellington so desperately needed for the Prussians to arrive.
The British light cavalry regiments attract scant coverage at Waterloo. The Scots Greys and the heavy cavalry attract naturally all the attention. The light cavalry did a lot of work, however, and it mustn't be forgotten that it was the light cavalry regiments that provided the support that actually got the heavy cavalry out of their predicament. And for the rest of the afternoon, they were the only real effective cavalry force that Wellington had, and they did great work in shooing away the French cavalry when they passed through the squares throughout the afternoon. Their role is pretty much overlooked. Now, each of the British light cavalry were armed with this. Same year, 1796. This is the light cavalry sabre that had been designed by John Gaspard Lamartine. Lamartine was one of the greatest soldiers, or potentially one of the greatest soldiers that we've produced, who set up the forerunner of Sandhurst, for example, and he killed in action at Salamanca in 1812. But this was a weapon that the French complained about. As you can see from the tip, it's wider than it is at the hilt, and it was capable of inflicting very fearful wounds on French infantry and cavalry. And if any of them were unlucky enough to feel either the blow from one of these or a cut, you know, it was fairly devastating. This, you know, very, very, very fearful weapon was one of these, much more effective than the heavy cavalry sabre, I might add.
With the drama of the Scots Greys now concluded, another of the day's pivotal moments occurred at Wellington's embattled centre.
It was probably around 3:30 in the afternoon, 3:30, 4 o'clock, that Wellington decided to pull back some of his front units from around his centre, under the shelter, a bit more under the shelter of the ridge, to get them out of the way of this tremendous artillery barrage that was coming in.
Ney, from his position in the valley, spotted this move, saw the Allied army begin to retreat as he saw it, and he could also see, further in the distance, a large number of what appeared to be refugees and wounded men streaming back through the forest of Soissons back towards Brussels.
Now, if your enemy is making a strategic withdrawal, the classic thing to do is to launch your mass cavalry attack. The enemy is withdrawing, you catch them in confusion, you cut up his infantry, you find his artillery wounded, and essentially that's how you finish a Napoleonic battle, by launching a mass cavalry attack.
Ney, impulsive at the best of times, decides to strike while he thinks the iron is hot, and he orders a French corps forward, a cavalry corps, which then charge southwest towards the ridge. Very soon, other corps, other regiments, are joining the attack, until 10,000 French cavalry are attacking the British line, unsupported either by artillery or infantry.
Out of the line of fire, invisible to Marshal Ney on the other side of the ridge, the British had formed their troops into hollow squares, the classic defensive tactic against a cavalry charge. Ney's French cavalry made several furious assaults, pouring over the ridge down these slopes against the well-prepared and utterly determined British infantry. Ney's bold horsemen made 12 attacks, all were repulsed. The carnage wrought by the British musket was appalling.
The conditions in the British squares very soon were appalling. You had a very hot summer's day, which didn't help with shortages of water, the constant firing of muskets, the choking smoke, and as the French cavalry drew near, some were armed with pistols, so they began to suffer casualties in those squares.
Now, what you have is the most extraordinary ability of the officers and the NCOs, at least the British regiments, to keep their men standing. There was not a single instance of a British battalion actually breaking when it's in a square. Some of the British cavalry didn't behave quite as well. There was one Hussar regiment which actually fled the battlefield. A number of the Dutch troops and German troops actually flee the battlefield. But the British infantry hold those squares. So the only way the French were actually going to be able to break through was to literally destroy them.
The British troops in the squares were coming under very intense pressure. They were facing unprecedented numbers of cavalry. The French were veteran troops, and they pushed their attacks in very hard. Although Ney had sent forward the cavalry without support, as the attacks continued to be pressed home by the French cavalry, they were able to bring up some guns, and horse artillery firing canister devastated some of the British squares. So the problem was becoming intense for the British. Fortunately, it was also becoming intense for the French, because they were losing exceptionally high numbers of casualties, and in fact the attrition on the French proved decisive, and they simply couldn't keep up the pressure on the British squares.
The real dilemma for the British infantry, and indeed the Dutch Belgian infantry, during the French cavalry attacks, was that while in their square formations, these dense formations of men packed together, they could certainly hold off the French cavalry. When the French cavalry withdrew, it meant that they were sitting ducks for the French artillery, and this meant that casualties began to mount alarmingly.
As with Hougoumont, the attack on the farm at Les Saints had proved extraordinarily difficult for the French. The fighting there had raged for several hours until finally at 5 p.m. the exhausted British ran out of ammunition and relinquished the farm.
At the point when La Haye Sainte fell, the British were at their lowest point in the battle. It really came down to the actions of a few battalions actually holding the line against the French attacks to actually prevent a major breakthrough.
One of the eyewitnesses, Captain Mercer of the Royal Artillery, quite candidly describes how he and one of his colleagues began to look around for a route of escape, because it certainly looked as if the whole British army was about to be swept away.
There were the French in possession of a farmhouse, literally 100, 200 yards from his centre. The French artillery are pounding away. We even got British cavalry shoring up the line, acting like infantry, the remnants of the heavy brigade of cavalry. There they were, standing, plugging a gap in the line. It was a very, very serious position Wellington found himself in on the evening of the 18th.
However, help for the British was finally at hand. At last, the advance guard of the Prussian army arrived on the field near the village of Plancemar. Without hesitation, the Emperor committed two battalions of the famous French Guard to the battle to try to keep the Prussians at bay. These magnificent troops joined the fray, and they soon expelled 14 of Blücher's Prussian battalions from the village. The redoubtable men of the Guard also succeeded in buying valuable time for Napoleon. In the British centre, Ney's cavalry attacks were at last being supported by artillery and now infantry. Inevitably, the exhausted British line began to waver. It was now obvious that one final French effort would win them the supreme reward.
With La Haye Sainte finally in French hands, Ney dashed back to Napoleon to try and get more troops to capitalise upon this opportunity. But Napoleon was very short with Ney. He said, "Troops, where do you want me to get them from? Do you think I can manufacture them?" Of course, the last reserve that Napoleon had was his old guard, and Napoleon, unaware of the true tactical importance of La Haye Sainte and the critical phase of the battle, refused to release those troops to Ney's command.
The old guard, we could really say, is Napoleon's trump card. He only plays it in moments almost of desperation. It's the last resort for him. At Borodino, for example, he delayed and delayed committing the Guard into action at a time when many of his marshals felt that throwing those men into the action would have won a decisive victory at Borodino. Similarly, at Waterloo, one gets the impression that Napoleon would have preferred not to have committed these troops, and he only did so when it was absolutely apparent that everything else had failed and he really needed to launch the Guard.
Napoleon delayed to an extent the attack by the Imperial Guard until he was very, very certain that it was make or break. He'd seen the Prussians making great inroads on his right in the village of Plancenoit, on his right rear. But he still sort of delayed. The guard was never really committed to action until the very final moments. It was like the battle-winning thrust, if you like. And really, he should have used them probably after the fall of Les Saints.
As Napoleon delayed, Wellington, hardly able to believe his good fortune, used the unexpected respite to reinforce and shore up his battered central position. This brief lull gave his troops just enough time to steady their frayed nerves and muster the strength they needed. By the time the French guard eventually rolled forward at 7 p.m, the British were ready to receive the world's most feared divisions.
When the guards set off, they branched off to the left, or to their left, and took the same route that the cavalry had taken earlier in the afternoon. Now, of course, once they chose that particular route, they were choosing a route that was churned up after those thousands and thousands of horses had been charging. Dead horses, wounded horses, scattered horses, as well as many, many dead bodies of French cavalrymen. So they were sort of picking a, what you might call a strange route, but it's understandable that they took that particular route, because there was just no way that they would have been able to deploy, you know, in that large formation straight up the Brussels Road. They had to come off one side or the other, pick the left, and up they went.
Never before defeated in battle, Napoleon's old and middle guards marched resolutely towards the British positions. But they were met by the British Brigade of Guards with such a withering hail of fire from their muskets that they stumbled, halted, and finally began to give ground. Wellington now recognized the decisive moment. He urged the brigade commander Maitland forward. "Now, Maitland, now's your time!" With a mighty roar, the whole British line charged forward and fell upon the Frenchmen, who faltered, hesitated, and then retreated. The unthinkable had happened. The invincible guard was beaten. The shock was almost tangible. In an instant, the whole French army was transformed from a cohesive military force into a confused and defeated throng. The survivors of the guard tried to regroup, but the British troops showed no mercy to those unfortunates who could not escape. Many more bodies were quickly added to the thousands which already littered the battlefield of Waterloo. Leaving the relative safety of the square which his guard had formed around him, the Emperor Napoleon soon joined the struggling, panic-stricken mass of French fugitives, a forlorn figure who knew that his final gamble had failed. Even today, the battlefield of Waterloo still hangs heavy with an extraordinary aura, an intangible testimony to the momentous events of 1815. On these gentle slopes and in these rolling valleys, more than 47,000 men from either side were killed or wounded during the day's hostilities. At the end of the battle, almost as if the heavens were crying out, a thunderstorm broke over the blood-soaked field. And in a final, cataclysmic thunderclap, Europe's future had been decided. A future free at last from the dogs of war.
It was a very interesting battle because it was anybody's until very, very late in the day.
I think Napoleon came very, very close to achieving a victory at Waterloo on the 18th of June, 1815. When Hay Saint fell to his infantry, things looked very, very black indeed for Wellington and the Allied army. But it's difficult to see, given the inroads that the Prussians were making into his rear, whether or not, even with Wellington's army breaking and trying to disengage, had they done so, how he could have achieved a complete victory. It's, you know, one of those imponderables of history, you know, what might have happened had Wellington's army broke and began to withdraw towards Brussels.
The Battle of Waterloo is special because it's one of the few engagements which produces a clear-cut victory which ends a campaign. After Waterloo, there were very few single battles which actually decided the issue, and this one did, of the whole war. In the American Civil War, that we can identify a turning point, for example, at Gettysburg, but the war dragged on for 2 years after that. Similarly, in the Great War, none of the real battles, such as the Somme or Verdun, or even in World War II, although Stalingrad might be seen as a turning point in World War II, it still dragged on for another 2.5 years after that. Waterloo was different. It was a single, decisive victory which actually decided the outcome of the campaign there and then.
The Duke of Wellington's victory at Waterloo assured him of a hero's welcome upon his return to London. In stark contrast, Napoleon's destiny was to be a sad exile. The Emperor was captured and collected by a British warship and sent to the inhospitable, rat-infested Atlantic island of St. Helens. There, the Emperor Napoleon spent his last remaining days reflecting on his former glories and turning over and over in his mind what might have been. What if Ney had taken Quatre Bras? What if Grouchy had arrived? What if Blücher had retreated east? As his physical health and spirit declined, Napoleon was no longer the proud emperor, but already the myths were beginning to grow around him as his old soldiers slipped away one by one. A broken man dwindling slowly into ruin. A man who had gambled and lost everything in the line of fire here on the field of Waterloo. Thank you.